That entire sequence was edited 100% on my iPhone using the Insta360 app. This app is seriously impressive when it comes to reframing 360 video. So in this video, I'm going to show you exactly how to use it and achieve sequences like the one you just saw, as well as all of the most important features of the Insta360 mobile app. Stay to the end for a really cool surprise feature that you probably didn't know about. Now you will need an Insta360 camera to use the Insta360 app. Start by downloading or updating to the latest Insta360 mobile app. Open it up, and before we get started with anything, we're going to change a few settings. Firstly, make sure the Nader logo is off. Secondly, make sure the shot on watermark is off. Now, something you've probably heard about is the shot lab, which can be found underneath the stories menu. And these are basically drag and drop templates that apply cool and catchy effects to your footage. I've got heaps of videos on my channel covering these, and they all come with their own built-in tutorial as well. But in this video, I'll show you how to manually keyframe your footage so you can get a more customized edit. And by the way, this workflow will cover how to reframe your shots as opposed to edit and export as an interactive 360 video. I will make another video in the future on how to do that. So the first step in this workflow is accessing your footage. And the great thing about Insta360 cameras is you can either edit straight from the SD card through a wireless connection or download to your device and edit from there. While the wireless workflow is convenient, I do prefer downloading my footage, as you can see here, because generally I found the editing times have been faster doing this. So once you've downloaded your shots, here are mine. I got them this past weekend in Tasmania, which is the little island at the bottom of Australia, where I went with my wife for a nice romantic weekend vacation with me, her, and a 360 camera, or two, or three. Now we're going to start by editing our clips one by one. The first thing you'll want to do is trim the top and tail from your clip. These are usually the bits where you're setting up your camera as well as buttoning off at the end. You don't need to get rid of everything straight away. It's better to have too much footage than too little, and we can always come back and retrim at the end. For longer clips, there's a jump cut option that lets you choose the best bits and get rid of everything else. Something else you'll need to do before you start reframing is choosing your aspect ratio. There are a few options: 9:16 if you want a vertical video, 16:9 for a regular horizontal one, as well as square, and 2.35:1 for those that are pretentious. I'd recommend 9:16 for Instagram stories, 1:1 for Instagram and Facebook, and 16:9 for YouTube. Okay, now let's keyframe, and there are five different ways to keyframe your shots depending on which workflow you like best. The first one can be found here, and that is autoframe. And what autoframe does is it chooses a few different frames that it thinks are noteworthy. So sometimes it chooses forward view, sometimes selfie view, and then a couple of other highlights. Personally, I wouldn't use this unless you're really short on time to edit. The next method is deep tracking your subject. And to do that, hold down the screen, then it will prompt you to drag to pick your subject. So draw a box around the person or object you want to track. And now it will automatically track you throughout the clip. If it messes up, which it shouldn't, but does sometimes, you can tap the little trash can icon to delete. Then you might want to try again and start the tracking at a different point in the clip. The next method, which is my favorite way to reframe, is using manual keyframes. So down the bottom, we have a timeline. If you press the plus icon, it adds a keyframe at the viewpoint your clip is currently at. If we move the timeline forward, we can create a new keyframe. Then hit the plus to add it. This is good because you don't always want the attention focused in one place. So at this point, I want to add a keyframe that points towards the rocks. So I'm going to do that. And now I want to add another one, but this time I'm also going to change the perspective a little bit. And you can do this at any point by just swiping around the screen and pinching to zoom. If you want to redo one of your keyframes, simply just move it to the position you want it to go, then tap update keyframe. And that's it. Manual keyframing creates a really customized edit, which allows you to point the quote unquote camera in any direction you like after the fact. The next way to reframe is using the Snap Wizard feature. And what this is it's basically a recorder where you tap the button, and when you move the field of view around, it's recording everything you're doing, which when played back ends up a little bit jerky and not quite smooth enough to use, in my opinion. A better way to do this is instead of using your fingers to reframe, long hold the record button and simply just move your phone around. Then the app will record all of your phone's movements. If you want to zoom in, swipe up on the bar on the right. If you want to zoom out, swipe down.
Whee!
Only do this if you've got a very steady hand. By the way, to play back at any point, all you need to do is tap the screen and it will start playing your animation. All right, maybe the spinny chair was a bad idea. You can reset your edits at any time within the app by choosing reset edit. Sometimes your edit just turns out so bad or dizzying that it's best to cut your losses and start again. Now I want to talk about speed and time shift, which is one of the best features of Insta360 cameras, where you get a nice smooth hyperlapse with the motion blur effect. And the best workflow for doing this is choosing your speed first. So with this clip here, I'm going to choose 16 times hyperlapse, which is usually the best speed for most scenes. Then we're going to drag the timeline across to cover everything we want to cover in a hyperlapse, which in this case is the entire clip. By default, it will turn motion blur on. The benefit of doing this first is that we now have a much shorter timeline to navigate and add keyframes to, as well as playback being a lot closer to what it will be like in the final clip. When reframing, you'll want to turn direction lock off so it doesn't mess with the keyframes we're about to add. So once you've added your hyperlapse effect, we're going to keyframe just like we did before. I'm going to keep it simple here with just 3 keyframes. And you'll get the full stabilized motion blur added hyperlapse after you export. Now I'm going to try a more advanced hyperlapse. So again, I'll choose speed 16 times, and using the viewfinder as a reference, I'm going to end the 16 here. Then I'm going to switch to 32 times because I pivoted around this pergola a couple of times. I want that to be twice the speed. Then on my way out, I want it to switch back to 16 times. So there, as you can see, I've added 16 times speed, then 32, then 16. Next, I'm going to keyframe this shot as I normally would. And if there's lots of movements, you will need to add quite a few keyframes. And here's how it turned out. The edits you make to individual clips should be saved by default. So if you exited and started editing another clip, then came back to the original clip, the edits will still be there with the keyframes and the speed adjustments. Another cool effect you might want to try if you're into punchy edits is we're going to go for a barrel roll. After you've added a hyperlapse, set your keyframes to between 1 and 4 seconds apart. For the second keyframe, I'm going to set the horizon straight, but this time I'm going to choose rotate. And what this does is it allows us to change the horizon. So I'm going to move it all the way across to 360 degrees, which means my shot is now doing a 360 degree flip while also doing a 32 times hyperlapse. Next, I'll cover an effect that I am very well known for, and that is the tiny planet. And there's not much to it really. It's pretty simple. You just move the frame around with your fingers, hit keyframe, move your shot along, and if you held your selfie stick straight, it should keep you somewhat straight, but you do also have the ability to manually keyframe tiny planets. And this was a really fun location. It was the House of Mirrors in Hobart in Tasmania, and this was a super fun location to shoot in 360. Of course, it's important not to overdo the tiny planet effect. I do think, as a tiny planet lover myself, you can overdo it, so try and keep it to 1 or 2 shots in your edits. They do have these default fields of view, by the way, but personally I prefer pinching to zoom and swiping to move around. Another effect in the editor is freeze frame, and this basically just slows down time. It's better for action type content, which I don't really shoot much of, but you can basically just set your start view and end view, and it does a super slow-mo transition between the two. The next cool effect you can achieve in the app is multi-view, and this is essentially like having a rear view mirror that presents 2 different viewpoints simultaneously within the same clip. So hit the plus icon, choose the footage you want to apply this effect to, then it's got 3 options for us to choose from. There's picture in picture, split screen, and there's car split screen. By default, it will lock in the forwards perspective, and you can adjust the backwards one as you like. So I'm just gonna go straight forwards and straight backwards. So when we play that back, how cool is that? In situations like this, when you truly do have 360 degree views, this is a really good way of showing it. You can also use this in closer situations to show two people in different parts of the shot. By the way, at any point, you can take a still snapshot of your 360 video if you wanna save it as a regular photo. Just tap the snapshot icon and we can choose to save it as a flat image or a 360 image. Next, I want to show you how to combine multiple clips into the same edit. And if you're doing any big edits like my hyperlapse here, I'd suggest doing it on its own here in the album tab. Then to combine them all, we're going to choose stories, create a story. Now you can navigate through your clips and choose them in the order you want to show them. Now here they are, multiple clips that we've just edited in the same timeline. You can add transitions to clips by tapping the box in between two clips, then choose transition style and length. You can also adjust your clip length here. So if you decided you don't need as much of the top or tail of one of your clips, you can adjust that. You can pinch to zoom in and out to see the full timeline. If you want to reposition clips, just tap, hold, then reposition. Or if you decide you don't want a clip at all, tap, hold, delete. You can still reframe your shots at this point by using this menu and repeating the reframing process from earlier. You can add music to your edit by tapping the music icon, and there's a small library with a few different genres of royalty-free music. You can make basic edits to the music, but don't expect anything too fancy. Going back to our video clips, and there are a few final options we can choose from, including filters or color correct manually if you prefer. Now it's time to export, and whether you're editing your clips individually or as a story, you'll find the export button up the top right. I like to choose a custom export because this sometimes allows us to increase quality through resolution, frame rate, and bit rate beyond what the auto settings would give you. Right now, the export resolution on mobile maxes out at 1440p. Then hit export and we are done. Okay, so I've gone back and re-edited all of the clips properly, combined them together in the Insta360 app using Insta360's own music. And hey, look at that. That is pretty good, if I do say so myself. And seriously, as a content creator, this app is gold. Some of these features you can't get in a lot of desktop softwares, yet you can get it completely for free within Insta360's own mobile app. And this is what I love about 360, is you can shoot first, point later. And that's exactly what we've just done. Now it's time for the surprise feature I mentioned at the start that you probably didn't know about. And that is the Insta360 app can also be used for reframing 360 photos. The way you do that is creating a story, but this time we're going to choose photos. Select your photo. Now we're going to drag the timeline out a bit. So I want my animation to last 10 seconds. I'm going to tap POV down the bottom left, then reframe. And now you can reframe exactly as I just showed you, but this time it's on a photo. So something like this, not bad. Or something like this, woo! Yeah, tiny planet, inverted planet, 360. Oh, I'm dizzy. So in today's video, you learn not only how to reframe 360 video with a high degree of control, but also 360 photos. Again, it has to be shot with Insta360 cameras in order to use this app. If you're into catchy effects with 360 cameras, then I wrote an ebook called A Beginner's Guide to Tiny Planet Photography, which I used to charge for a couple of years ago, but now I'm offering it completely free. So if you want to learn the A to Z of tiny planet effects completely free, then I'll link that below. And that's it for this video. I'm feeling very dizzy. Hey, what is your favorite way of using the Insta360 app? Let me know down below. Leave a like if this video was helpful, subscribe for more, and I'll see you next time.